mm-hmm. right? The interaction of mm-hmm. this requirement with the felon disenfranchisement laws acts effectively as a poll tax. You have to pay to play.
I was wondering if maybe you could start out with a 30-second overview of some voter rights legislation, constitutional protections.
The U.S. Constitution says that in regards to federal elections, states have the power to make the rules, but Congress also has the power to amend those rules as it sees fit. There's a number of federal laws that impact what the right to vote actually means. And often when we talk about this, everybody thinks about the Voting Rights Act of 1965, which gives teeth to the promise that ended up being betrayed of the 15th Amendment in order to protect the right to vote from racial discrimination.
Why would you say that the promise of the 15th Amendment has been betrayed?
When the 15th Amendment was passed in 1870, ratified, I should say, the promise then was that African-American men would be granted the franchise. And certainly during Reconstruction, there was significant African-American voting, and we saw some of the first elected African-American officials, both state and federal. But then with the coming of Jim Crow, those laws were decimated, particularly the Southern ex-Confederate states passed rules like poll taxes, reanimated felon disenfranchisement laws. There were literacy requirements. There was, you know, the infamous understanding test, where even if you couldn't literally read, say, a provision of the Constitution or a technical provision of state law, one could have it read to them, and then the prospective voter had to state an understanding to the satisfaction of the registrar of voters. And most historians would point to 1910 as sort of the nadir of the African-American vote, where you went from voter registration of African-Americans somewhere in the 70s to 80% range. By 1910, it was 10%. And the Supreme Court, over the first half of the 20th century, in a series of opinions, basically upheld most of those regulations designed to disenfranchise African Americans.
I think people, like, the word poll tax is familiar to people, but I think it'd be really interesting to hear you explain how poll taxes actually work to disenfranchise African Americans.
So a poll tax was designed to require every citizen of voting age to, in essence, pay a tax by a designated time in order to be eligible in order to vote. It's literally a pay-to-play system. If we're thinking about that sort of 1910s period of $2 to $3, you can imagine that in today's money, we're talking significantly more than just $2 to $3. And in order to register to vote and on election day, one had to present their receipts from, say, the past two federal election cycles. The manager of the polls would ordinarily, and particularly with African Americans, expect technical compliance with all of these rules. African Americans at the turn of the 20th century, who were only a generation out of slavery, most of them being poor, added tax on top of their tax obligations and sustenance needs would be overly burdensome for them to meet.
Do you see parallels between some of the voter laws that states have today and the system of poll taxes?
I think that over the past two decades, we have seen the growth of a new kind of hyper-regulation of the political process that makes it harder for the poorest people to vote. And in that group are largely poor people of color, right? Okay. And I think that gets represented in the debates that we have over voter identification laws, in the debates that we have over proof of citizenship laws, and notwithstanding the fact that 90% of Americans can easily afford their birth certificate, there, according to the census, there are 10% who can't. The presumption ought to be that that 10% should be easily included as well. And Florida is illustrative, right? In a 2018 referendum, Amendment 4 was on the Florida ballot. It passed overwhelmingly, abolishing the permanent felon disenfranchisement clauses in the Florida Constitution. But of course, in the next legislative term, the legislature interprets the amendment through legislation to say, well, before a voter can enjoy the benefit of this amendment, they have to pay all fines, restitution, and the like to the state of Florida, which brings us full circle. Right, the interaction of this requirement with the felon disenfranchisement laws acts effectively as a poll tax. You have to pay to play.